Hello, welcome to Gamegasm, and I'm Bren.
I'm Dan.
I almost forgot who I was.
That's unbelievable.
I know, right? Like,
why has he started with and? How does this go?
I am Bren, honestly. And what are we playing today?
It is medieval.
Aye,
spelled evil.
Evil. Mm. Not the traditional spelling of
medieval.
Oh, yeah, look, Fortescue.
Ah, there he is.
That's the graveyard. That is the evil dude that's bringing everything back to life, isn't he?
Ooh. Zarok.
Zarok.
I had to write that down. I'm not going to lie.
But, and this is Medieval on the PS1. It's such an awesome game.
I feel like I say this nearly every time we do one of these, but it's one of those ones I wanted to play, but other than the demo, I never played it.
Never got to, no. In my younger...
Wanted it so bad.
Yeah, in my youth, I missed out on it too. But this is the intro to the menu.
Oh, that's cool.
So there's the title to the game, and... And it just roams through the graveyard, and eventually we'll get to a tombstone.
This is awesome.
It's amazing, isn't it? I love anything Halloween-y and
stuff. It feels
stuff like
more N64 than PlayStation.
Yeah, and it's like
cool.
I really like it. It's kind of like it's got that Nightmare Before Christmas kind of vibe.
It was influenced by that.
There you go.
Definitely, and the soundtrack.
Yeah, the soundtrack's very Danny Elfman.
Danny Elfman.
Yeah, yeah. So, but yeah, it's kind of this constant state of horror Halloween land brought on by Zarok.
Well, that'll be why you like it.
Yeah.
You like Halloween.
That's it. It's my favourite holiday.
Halloween.
Yeah. Hello.
Halloween.
Halloween. So yeah, the cutscenes are really good in this as
well,
aren't they?
There he is.
Yeah,
naughty Zarok. Man.
Yeah, his voice is hilarious though.
So he's I did do a little bit of research on the story.
Yeah.
Not that you really need to know the story, but basically Zarok in 1286 was fighting a battle. So Daniel Fortescue was leading the attack. He was the first killed, I think.
Yeah, he took an arrow, as we just saw in the cutscene.
That
there.
Was the end of him. Then Zarok went into hiding. 100 years later, Zarok comes out of hiding, uses magic to raise his undead army, which also brings back to life Dan.
Fortescue.
And he wants to redeem himself.
Yes, because he failed so long ago that now he's come back to face the hordes. And
restore his name and his pride.
That's it. So
go.
and go we shall.
That's really cool, isn't it?
Yeah. And it's funny because he's got no jaw. He can't actually speak. So the dialogue in the game, he's all like,
he's just top teeth.
It's like really muffled and stuff. So like these guys are just telling us, like giving us some...
Oh, the gargoyle heads. Yeah, they kind of guide you, don't they?
That's right, yeah. And one of them's a shop as well.
Yeah. Oh, that'll be your first weapon there then.
So there's me. There's
the blue ones are the shops, aren't they? I think.
Yes.
I think green gargoyles are assistants.
Direction.
And the blue ones are shop.
Yeah.
An open book like that can only mean... actually, maybe it's just scenery, but can you read them?
You can read them. They give you clues and hints and stuff like that. There you go. So like, you must be able to shape out of... after 100 years, lying on your back, use the crypt to get to grips with your new lease of life. So this is kind of like a little tutorial area and stuff. So,
so this was the work of a company that started off called Millennium Interactive.
Yeah.
Started on it in the mid-90s for the Saturn and PC.
Oh, wow.
Sony got wind of it at some point in the development, and it was headed up by a guy called Chris Sorrell, who was largely behind the James Pond platform games on earlier consoles.
James Pond.
Classic. I'm surprised they didn't get sued, but that's a story for another time.
Yeah.
And Sony bought Millennium Interactive and renamed it SCE Studio Cambridge, which you will have heard of.
Yes.
And this was their first game under that name. So I don't know if they ever got it running on the Saturn or the PC. I presume there was a version of it that did. But
you know what? That's actually worth looking for, because I bet it would look really good.
I'm not sure it got released, though, on the Saturn.
Maybe it didn't, no.
I'll have to look that up. I think it maybe only got released on the PlayStation in the end, because it was Sony-owned by the time they released the game.
Yeah. So, obviously...
Cool.
You need to get those.
Put the tablet in the hand.
See that, the like... Bottle. Yeah, you get... basically,
is
if you take...
the top now?
That's right, yeah. If you take damage... obviously, your energy goes down. But if you've got one of those life jars, when it gets to the bottom, it replenishes your health. It gives you another go, if you like.
So it's like a life, essentially.
Yeah, yeah. So, obviously...
And you collect the bottles, don't you, and you can refill them.
That's right, yeah, through pools of little fountains of health.
Yes. Health tains.
We'll go with that. Yeah. So,
ooh, map.
Yeah, you get an overworld kind of thing.
Chalices, are they?
Yeah, the chalices are... Oh, where are my Dan's crypts? Oh, there we go.
Go to the graveyard.
The chalices, basically, when you kill enemies in a level, it fills that chalice up with soul energy. When it gets to 100%, you can collect a chalice from the level. It becomes collectible.
Gotcha.
Then you collect that, you take it back to the Hall of Heroes, and you get given a gift by one of the heroes. So,
so your kind of upgrade tree, if you like.
Cooler gear.
And
they give you new weapons, and like at the moment I've got like a sword and throwing daggers, but we'll
can't
stick
you have
with
like
a
crossbow later on as well?
Yeah, you get that not too far in the game. I'm not sure we'll get it now. It is a zombie.
That's a cool animation of the coffin coming out the ground.
Yeah, it's really cool. Obviously,
that hand.
Yeah, they don't hurt you though. So they're just kind of like scenery items.
Okay, that's cool.
Here's the zombies.
Zombies.
You can also hold down the square button and charge it up.
That's cool.
He does a big spinny attack. So it's quite funky.
I found out what the working title for this game was. I really like it.
Go on.
Dead Man Dan.
Dead Man Dan?
Yeah.
Yeah, that works.
Yeah.
Why not?
So they obviously didn't change the name of the main guy.
Dan Fortescue, here to stay. So yeah, the levels kind of comprise of these, like, you find earth runes that open the earth rune door, and there's chaos runes and all that kind of jazz. And there's different things hidden around the levels, and it's generally very, very fun. As you can see here.
I love these kinds of platform games anyway. I'm not really too fussed about how old they are.
Yeah, see, now Medieval, this is one of those healthtains.
You remembered it, I didn't.
So it's just filled my health up. But nice. Eventually they do disappear.
Yeah.
Well, I've got the Earth Rune, I can go through.
So colour-coded hand, tablet, door.
Yeah, obviously the Earth Runes and the puzzles in general get a lot more complex as the game goes along.
It's starting you out easier.
Yeah, it's showing you the ropes. So here's a Chaos Rune that will obviously open the Chaos door.
Yeah.
What's
this red?
This is money. Money can be used to buy, replenish items like your throwing daggers and your crossbow arrows and stuff like that from a shop, which is good. Also, the shield I've got, if you press triangle, you get a shield.
Oh, yeah, you get a block.
And you see the number in the top left there. That's
150.
That's how much energy the shield's got.
Okay.
So every time you take a hit, that goes down. So this is the red door, look.
Oh, there it is, yeah. I see it. The hand.
Yeah, you just walk near it and off you go.
This is fantastic. You're doing well with your chalice.
Yeah, it's almost done. I mean, like, obviously this is just showing me the ropes kind of thing. But this game, like I know you were saying, like it's very kind of like N64 platformery.
Yeah.
There's not a lot of platforming in Medieval. It's kind of a balance between some platforming and then it's combat.
Yeah,
because the combat's quite different. So
doing my research, one of the websites called it a hack and slash adventure.
Yeah, it is it's definitely new. I think that's the secret that unlocks the chalice, but we can't pick it up yet. I don't think
because you haven't got
100%. Because we haven't got 100%. So
that's
you can
cool.
find out where they are.
Yeah, but you
but
can't
then
pick
you
them
can't
up.
Pick them up until you've got 100%. So when I get further around here and kill some more enemies, it should tell me. The chalice can now be collected. So
I know you could argue that games like Crash Bandicoot had lusher graphics than this, but they were essentially corridor games. Whereas this is a free-roaming 3D platform game on the PlayStation, which is commendable, really. Like Spyro as well.
Those games, awesome.
You
like
always got
Spyro,
the feeling that they were really tearing through the chip. They were just on the edge of working, didn't you? Oh, I really appreciate it.
I'm getting gang-banged.
There you go.
See, look, the chalice can now be collected. So we can.
Are we far away from it?
No, it's only around the corner.
Oh,
so
you can.
Yeah, and you can jump back.
That's really cool.
So we'll just go back around here and pick up that chalice because you get a nice gift in the Hall of Heroes. I think the first gift is actually, it's either a hammer or the crossbow itself.
Cool. Oh, that'd be good to see.
Yeah, so.
Either or.
There we go. So we got it. The Hall of Heroes awaits. So
lovely.
Once we finish this very small level, we will see the,
the heroes.
Hall of Heroes, yeah. And also, it has kind of backtracking of the overworld map as well, where you couldn't get to certain areas until you've done certain things elsewhere.
Yeah.
So there's a bit of backtracking.
More like an exploration then, kind of like Banjo was a world.
And there's some secrets too, like this one.
Oh.
If I'm not going to be able to get around there now, am I? Now I've bigged it up, my knowledge of secrets.
So there's
like a treasure chest and another health bottle up there. I'll try one more time, but for the sake of this.
I believe you can do this.
It is very fiddly.
Yeah.
I won't lie, it's very fiddly. Because you kind of have to. It's easier if you can use the analog sticks, but I haven't got it set up on here at the moment. No. We're playing it through the PS3, and it's gone into its digital mode. So,
well, it was one of the first analog compatible games, I think.
It was. It actually has a sticker on the box that says "Analog Recommended." Yeah. So here's the shop as well, where you can spend money. I haven't got enough gold yet, but you can spend money to get your daggers and stuff like that. There we go.
But I dug out this old magazine review of Medieval
from
the time.
From 98?
There's a great pick. Yeah, 98. Yeah. November 98, when Metal Gear Solid came out. It's actually got a really great bit of artwork of him holding an analog controller.
Oh, yeah, look at that. That's really
cool.
That's
a really cool picture, isn't it?
So, you know what? I'm going to try one more time.
Yes.
Just because, for the folks at home.
I think a lot of people at the time, it got good reviews, but a lot of people said, yes,
yeah, there you
always
go.
Try one more time.
Always try one more time.
Always.
There you go.
But
so
it is notorious for being slightly fudgy with its controls.
It's different. Yeah, it's not
not in
not
a
perfect.
Horrible way, but just a little bit.
Yeah.
And you can get through. Can you get back?
I think you can walk up to the other side of that and see all the goodies that await.
Oh, it's your hint.
Yeah. Yeah. Also, this is quite a cool thing. Not only can you rotate the camera left and right by using the L2 and R2, but if you hold both of them at the same time, you get Dan mode.
Dan cam.
So you can actually, you know, proper look around.
Yeah.
Which was quite unique for the time. I don't know many games that did that. 3D games. I'm not sure. Did Spyro do it?
I can't remember how you controlled the camera in Spyro. I think it might have been. The buttons. Yeah. Yeah.
But I will
Unless
say
you had the analog pad potentially, but I can't remember now. It's been so long.
I will say one of the crushing things about this game is the camera is awful.
Yeah.
If they ever did a proper full-on remake of this, I'm sure the camera would be much better. But
The analog pad was brand new, wasn't it? And it probably didn't exist when they started development. So a lot of these early analog games, it was quite fudged in at the last minute.
That's right.
It?
Yeah.
You didn't
have
the two-stick control that's become standard now. You kind of know off by heart. It's just
that's right. And even in the analog version, you don't control the camera with the right stick.
No.
It's still on the shoulder buttons.
On the shoulder buttons. Crazy,
yeah.
Eh?
Yeah, absolutely.
Can you swing the sword with the analog stick? They were quite innovative, weren't they? I'm thinking of Ape Escape.
Yeah,
Net.
That was the first one that used. That was the first analog game, I believe.
You had to have an analog pad for that.
Yeah, it
you can
actually
play
sold
one.
It sold the game with.
Yeah, with a pad.
With a
pad.
Oh dear.
Oh no! Into the river.
Yeah, that's the thing. Dan Fortescue can wade through shallow water, but go into deep water, and he can't do it. So,
gotcha. So it's
the game's
back on
way.
Land.
And there's a good example of a life bottle getting used.
Yes.
So here we go. This is the end of the level.
Do we get to see the Hall of Heroes?
Yeah, we do, yes. That's where we're going right now.
Oh, we didn't need the gargoyle, did we?
No. He just says, go through here and the level ends.
Thanks.
So, yeah, you get taken straight to the Hall of Heroes. And this is kind of like the game's central hub kind of thing where there's statues of heroes in the main hall.
So you can talk to them all.
Yeah, he's basically going to tell you exactly what I'm about to tell you. And on the bottom level, there's like all these statues. The one that's glowing green is the one that's going to talk to me because I've got the chalice.
The lighting's really good, isn't it?
Yeah, it is very atmospheric. There's all these statues around here. And there is an upper floor, but you can't get there until you've appeased all of the heroes on the lower floor. So you see like there's ghost stairs. So if you try and go up there, you just fall through. So you have to get enough chalices to appease these.
How many are there, Daniel?
I think there's four. Yeah, there's four. So if I stand on this now, it should fill up. And this chap is going to give me something cool. So, Captain Fortescue, it's me, Canny Tim. Does the battle go well? So, there you go. You can take my crossbow. He gives us the crossbow. So, will you accept? Yes, I will. And not that there's anything clever about shooting someone in the eye, sir. Yeah.
He has one eye.
Yeah.
I fear we may have just learnt his backstory.
Yes, that's where the arrow went. Okay, so now we've got the crossbow.
Why is it angry?
What, an angry crossbow? Oh. Jesus. Anyway, on to the next level, which is a really cool level, actually. I've probably
not seen this, you know.
No, well, it's a return to the graveyard.
Okay.
So we'll leave the Hall of Heroes. And then after that, there's a really cool one in a field of scarecrows, where it's all kind of like Halloween-y style scarecrows.
Wow.
And there's a pumpkin gorge where it's all kind of like pumpkin grove and stuff like that.
The map's clearing.
That's right. Yeah, every time you complete like a level, you kind of we won't save the progress. You unlock a new area kind of thing. So we can go up and this is Cemetery Hill. Yeah, this is kind of the first kind of you're trying to get to Zarok, because you're on his case trying to rid the land of all this nastiness that's befallen it and redeem your knightly status. So here we are. And all the levels start out kind of like, you know, graveyardy and stuff. Yeah. But then there's like an enchanted forest. Yeah, yeah. And this bit's kind of like Ghostbusters. Look at that. Listen to that voice.
Wow.
You're too late, Fortescue. Already my army has risen from the grave.
Kind of sounds like, what's that? Sean Pertwee?
Yes. It does sound like that, gravelly.
Yeah, yeah, it just sounds like him. Like, but it sounds like him if he was putting on a higher voice kind of thing. God, I hope it... What if it is him?
You never know.
So this level actually reminds me of... I'm just going to swap back to the sword. I'll show the crossbow.
Oh, nice. So that bounced back then, didn't it?
Yeah, see the little fairy thing that's flowing around you?
Yeah, yeah.
When you've got like a ranged weapon, it's showing what you locked onto.
That's clever, I like that.
So there you go. But let's and when you pause the game to swap items and look at your things, it stops all the enemies and stuff, so you can kind of sort out who you want to swing your sword at. I swear there was another zombie around here.
I think you got him with your...
No, there he is.
Oh, no, you found him.
Come here. Because obviously it's important...
I thought one of your arrows went off at a stranger.
Oh, right, yeah. No, it's important to get all the zombies, because obviously, especially if you want to get your chalice and
chalice
stuff. So, yeah, this level reminds me of that level from Mario 64.
Oh, the first level.
Yeah, when you've got to climb up to the top of the hill to get the Bob-omb King.
Bob-omb?
Yeah, similar story. You've just got to... Oh, that's an instant use health file.
Okay.
You've just got to get to the top, and then the boulders stop basically.
Gotcha.
But getting to the top is no easy task.
No, it doesn't sound it.
As we have to kind of use our shield, which is quite important here. That you can't get through there until you get the club.
Right, and smack them out of the way.
Yeah, it smashes the boulders kind of thing. So... right, it's time to try and get through this. Now, last time I did this, I was terrible at it, so...
Oh, I see. Is that a little shortcut?
It is, yeah. I'm going to make sure my shield's up. Boom.
Okay.
So you can jump over them as well.
That's cool. Oh,
took a couple of hits there. Not
too bad. Not the end of the world.
Oh,
you got away with that.
I did, yeah. That was lucky, wasn't it? Oh, come on.
Here we go.
Oh, there you
smack.
Go.
Pushes you backwards as well.
It does,
cruel,
and
it?
I've not got a lot of shield left.
Oh, I see. Yeah, of course.
So I'm going to try and
start moving up here. Then,
yeah, I'm going to try and just go for it. I'm gunning it.
Chest.
Whoa. Oh dear, it came down there. That's all right. We're gunning it.
You're doing good.
I'm ignoring the chests on purpose.
Down,
yeah, you can come back down, and it's much easier to get everything.
Yeah.
Once you've got up here.
Oh,
so there you go.
There. Nice.
Boom. So then these guys are like, "Oh no, we failed the master. We give our lives." And then they just die.
Huh, that's cool. And they've given you a health
Health tane. Yeah, just here. So all that health you lost trying to get up there, you can now.
Yeah.
Bring it back.
Nice.
But yeah, so this is what the game's like.
It's brilliant, isn't it?
It's a beautiful, colourful game inspired by Nightmare Before Christmas.
Yeah.
There's a sequel as well. They did briefly remake it, didn't they?
They did on the PSP, I think.
Yeah, on the PSP. But I never played that version. I'm not sure if it's an exact, just a direct port, boosted it in any way.
And there was a direct sequel in 2000 as well, wasn't there?
Yeah, the Medieval 2.
Yeah.
Yeah. On the PlayStation, though.
Yeah.
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 And, it's just a fantastic game. I would recommend this to anyone that loves Spyro.
I'm going to be buying this later on, I think.
Oh, it's such an awesome game. And, it just... There's bosses in it. There's just lovely environments, the music, it all comes together to create this incredible Halloween styled world with some great characters. So, yeah, medieval.